Wow. Can we, yeah, okay, good. We're gonna move all this trappings out of the way so the light doesn't blind me. But you know, we're gonna talk together today, gang. We're gonna spend some time looking at issues. We're gonna talk about Little Rock, yes, but there are many other issues. In fact, when you think about the story of Little Rock and its place in the movement toward social justice for all, we have to think of it as a comma, not as a period, in any sentence written about civil rights, because the job is not done. Nothing really of true significance has happened, which may sound like a rather outlandish statement, just to follow up what was said in introduction, but my personal feeling is we could do so much better. My expectation is that we can do so much better. So to that end, we're gonna spend time today talking to each other. I will start the conversation with a monologue, which is kind of neat. You know, you listen to late night news programs, right? Well, they're not news programs, I guess, but they are late night programs. And you usually get the monologue, and then you get the guest and a lot of other stuff. You even get entertainers, people who will sing and dance. I might even sing today, I don't know. Just depends. I have a mic. So whenever you have a mic, you have the right to sing if you want to. So I was first introduced to the universe on December 3rd, 1941. I was shocked because I landed in a place called Little Rock, Arkansas. And if you know just the slightest bit about American history, you will know that Little Rock was not by any means the most propitious place for a person like me to come charging out of the womb in 1941. The law was arrayed against me. Custom was against me. Everything that I could think of was not in my favor. It was not a time of positive reflection for me. I wanted to escape Little Rock. I thought I'd been born in the wrong place. Well, turns out I had no choice. None of us have choice. Wherever your mom is, that's where you are. Where were you born? You were born in Brookline. Local person, very cool. Did you choose to be born in Brookline? Well, no, see, there you are. Neither did I choose Little Rock. But you make the best of it. Now, one of the first things I did was to begin to ask questions about why things were the way they were. Nobody seemed to have adequate answers. Obviously, some time has elapsed, right? Because I now have the power of speech. But you follow me, right? Okay, you fill in the blanks. So as I acquired the power of speech, I began to use it to find out what's going on here. How did this situation ever come to this point? How does such a situation ever pertain? Well, the responses were quite interesting. A lot of people said to me, don't talk about that stuff. Don't bring up those kind of questions. Don't rock the boat. Don't cause trouble. And that last one especially, I thought, this is weird, cause trouble. You see, in my estimate, the trouble was there when I arrived. How could I be accused of causing trouble, right? But that's the way people are. So I backed off, and I began to do research underground. I had to go underground and do my research. I started ferreting through the historical annals to find out what had happened. I kept digging and digging and digging. I got all the way back to the year 1619. I tell you, I went far afield. But I had to, because in order to figure out what was going on in 1941, I had to go back to 1619. You know, the thing about being born at any period in time, what year in Brookline? See, 2001. He's very new to the universe, right? Okay. But a lot of stuff happened before 2001, right? Do you know anything about that? Rhetorical, you don't have to answer. But that's a plight we all have. Whenever you're born, you have to realize that before you, there was life. Lots of it. So I began to find out what this life was all about, going all the way back to 1619. Well, why 1619? Any of you history students have any clue about that? Wow, that's cool. I forgot about the pilgrims. But the other stuff was going on too. I was actually thinking about Africans who came over as slaves in 1619. Pilgrims are cool. But, so there we were, 1619. And all historians tend to agree these days, that was the first time recorded that slaves were actually, well not slaves, but Africans were imported from Africa to be slaves in this country. And they began to engage in the free labor that essentially built the economy that is now supporting us in the year 2014. You see, and I want to make this point. Because a lot of people don't understand the historical relevance of stuff that happened then. Too many people feel that history is stuff that happened years ago and no longer has relevance. Untrue. Anything that ever happens in time or space is simply and merely antecedent to everything else that will ever happen. Can't be any other way. Your ability to have been born in 2001 in Brookline meant that you had to have ancestors who came forward in orderly progression until you appeared. And at some point, you will take up the mantle and begin to add to that line. I'm projecting, of course. But that is what most of us aspire to. Well, in any case, when you really understand the historical relevance of everything that happened, then you get the picture. We cannot truly understand 2014 unless we fully understand 1619. Because a lot of the policies and the programs and the institutional practices, ways of thinking, are rooted in that year, 1619, very directly so. I knew none of this when I first arrived, but as I began to develop habits that allowed me to be a true student, which as I look around, I sense all of you are good students, right? You're a good student? Yes, haha, you're a good student? Very cool, see, right here. Just took a sampling, just a sampling on this front row, second row. Only one person on the front row here. They told me all the A students were gonna be on the front row. So the superintendent is the only A student? Are you kidding me? Well, we'll see about that. So, I was disturbed to no end as I began to find out these truths. And you know what else I found out? Rather than teach the truth in our schools, we get something different. We get a nationally approved narrative, which is mythological in the main. That's a problem. But not here at Bedford. You guys get the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, right? Superintendent told me earlier. So I'm convinced. And that's good, because you need the truth. Why? Because without the truth, you cannot understand truly the reality you face in 2014. This was my plight in 1941. I knew nothing, so I had to learn. I got to school eventually, first grade, I'll never forget, 1947, 6 years old, Terry Roberts in the first grade. Can you imagine that? Well, I'd been ripped out of my life of leisure. From 1 to 6, I lived a true life of leisure. I could get up, poke around, decide what to do on a given day. Then all of a sudden somebody said, you gotta go to school. Are you kidding me? What is this school? You have to get your education. What do you mean, my education? What is that? And everywhere I would turn, people would say to me, boy, get your education. Boy, get your education. Whoa, okay. First grade came along, but it didn't take long. Once I got to first grade, lights came on. Aha, I understand this education thing. This is where you have free access to information and you can learn. And regardless of what the teachers were telling me, I could read eventually for myself to find out the truth. Your task is that. So the first grade teacher said to all of us 6-year-olds, you kids have to take on executive responsibility for learning. You have to become CEO of your own independent learning enterprise. Made sense to me. Make sense to you, young man? In the orange? By the way, that's my older grandson's favorite color. He wouldn't take that from you, but he'd surely want it. Anyway, I paid attention to the first grade teacher. The Terry Roberts Learning Academy was established in September of 1947 and has been an active enterprise since. As a consequence, I became a good student. Not that I was a brilliant kid, but when you put in the work, you get the results. And I know all of you are hardworking students, right? Look around. Some faces, yeah, okay, but some of you I need to talk to later. Well, at any rate, I began to learn and learn, and I was continually shocked as I got more information. But I continued on. Age 13. And age 13, this would be 1954, the Supreme Court acted, and what was the case in 54? Come on, kids, stay with me. 1954, Supreme Court, US, education. You got it. Brown v. Board of Education. Now, I want you to imprint that on your brains, because that is really an important decision. Because in 1954, the court said, and get this, pay attention to the language, it is no longer constitutional to discriminate. No longer constitutional. Prior to that, it was constitutional. How long prior? Well, we go back to that date I mentioned, 1619. Question, how many years between 1619 and 1954? Somebody do the math. Use your smartphone if you need to. Okay, go for it. Close. 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 Did you say Did you say 200? I'll give you a clue. 16 from 19 is 3. 335. 3, 3, 5. Okay. Doesn't take Bedford long. 335. Now, think with me, kids. 335 years of constitutionally supported discrimination. What happens if you do something for 335 years? Take a guess. What happens if you do something, anything, for 335 years? Yeah, it becomes habitual. You become good at it. You enjoy it. You don't want to give it up. And that's what happened in 1954. When the Supreme Court said, we're going to cease and desist, no more discrimination, what did Americans do? Yell and scream, no! Over 100 members of our own US Congress, well, we shouldn't be too surprised by that group. Well, over 100 members of that group pinned their names to something that we know as the historical document, the Southern Manifesto. In the Southern Manifesto, these 100 congresspeople pledged to do whatever they were allowed to do, whatever was within their power, to prevent implementation of the Brown decision. Now, that did not sit well with me, because I was ecstatic. The law was finally on my side. Terry Roberts had an advocate at the Supreme Court. People could not discriminate based on the law. However, what I found out, people did discriminate because they did not think the law was just. So even though the law changed in 54, nothing else changed with it. The social, the cultural, the emotional, the psychological, the ideological, all of that stuff remained in place. Again, an explanation for why things are so crazy still in 2014. So we can still have stuff like Ferguson, Missouri erupting because of stuff that happened along the way. It's all very obvious if you take a close look at it, although it's very disturbing. In any case, I was excited still, even though things were sort of in an uproar. And when the Little Rock School Board decided that they would obey this law and put a plan together to desegregate schools, I was one of the early volunteers. In fact, the count was off by one. I had two hands up. Oh, yeah, I'm going. So I was counted twice. So the official number is wrong. Any rate, we went home then and told our parents, because all this happened at school, we went home and told our parents, we have volunteered to join this group, we're going to desegregate the school. And parents, in many cases, said, you what? Ha. Well, you could hear parental vetoes being stamped all over Little Rock. No, no, no. Except in 10 households. We were, for a brief moment, the Little Rock 10. How many of you knew that? Well, yes, because Jane Hill was among our group. Jane Hill would have been the 10th member. But Jane's father received a telephone call on the night before school was to start. If you allow Jane to continue going through with this plan to desegregate, don't bother coming back to work. Your job is history, as we would say. Well, he lost his job anyway after he pulled her out. Oh, thanks, sir. He's looking out for my welfare and well-being. Great to have people like that on your team. So we became the Little Rock Nine. People say, well, why would you? Lots of reasons. I think for me, the fact that I could see that what was happening was unjust, illegal, immoral, unreasonable, made no sense. How could that ever have been? In my world, the change was to finally get back to true reality. Well, this was not the attitude of a lot of people in Little Rock. In fact, a lot of people started yelling and screaming right away, including the governor of the state. You've probably studied about Orville Faubus, a man who was reelected 6 times in Little Rock. And I mention that simply because sometimes people say, well, he wasn't really reflecting the will of the people. Well, if you're reelected 6 times in a row, you're reflecting something. At any rate, he and his minions came out in force to protest the 9 of us going to this formerly all-white high school. Interesting way to describe it, isn't it? All-white, as if anything could be. Well, in any case, we showed up on day 1, ready to go to school, but the governor had acted by calling out the National Guard to keep us out, Arkansas State National Guardsmen, young men who were not that much older than we were. We were essentially 14 to 16. They were 18 to 20. Young men designed to keep us out. And they were tough. Most soldiers are pretty tough, especially if they have guns. I don't know how they are without guns, but that's another story. At any rate, and they kept us out. They wouldn't let us in. We tried to get back into school several times, but nothing would work. Finally, the president, Eisenhower, Dwight Eisenhower, sent in the 101st Airborne Division to escort us to school. And you might think that that meant things were a lot better for us. No, things were actually worse, because people in Little Rock were considering that this was forced upon them. You probably heard or read in historical reports that people in Little Rock felt that they were being forced to do something they didn't want to do. They were angry about it. And they wanted to kill us, basically. I remember on first day hearing voices in the crowd saying, hang him, hang him. Some guy had a rope. But he couldn't get any traction because he had poor leadership skills, which is okay. It's probably healthy for me that he was a poor leader. Anyway, eventually the Army came and took us to school. But even with the Army, things were really bad. As they might say, even here in Bedford, it was on between us and them. And we, the 9, pledged nonviolence. We were not going to fight, which was really good for me because I don't like to fight anyway. I'm like you, no fighting. I'm glad to be in a school where kids don't fight with each other. But at that school, people actually did fight. They fought against us. Life was hellish, really. Before some of these kids walked out, because many of them wouldn't stay in school with us, they said, they'd said they weren't going to school with black people, although they had other terms for us. And they said, as long as you're here, we're leaving. One thing I remember thinking, that's pretty strange. You're willing to sacrifice your own means of educating yourself, i.e. using the school and its resources, in the name of segregation. So they vowed never to come back, and many of them did not. They just left school, dropped out. Who knows what became of them? My hunch is it was not a good thing. But anyway, those who remained were not that happy that we were there. And so they ganged up on us. I had a personal assailant, this kid who self-assigned himself to pick on me, to beat me up. His name was Jerry Tully. Now, I have not seen Jerry Tully since those days, and I don't know if he lives in Bedford or not, but if you bump into him, just tell him hello. Tell him that I inquired about his health and well-being. He'll be about my age, hopefully in good shape. You never know. Bigots are not known to have good diets. But anyway, at the height, we were in fear of our lives on a daily basis. Somebody asked me once, what can you remember most about being in that school? Well, fear always comes to mind. I had never been that afraid in my life. I thought if you were that afraid, you would probably just keel over and die because you couldn't live with that degree of fright. But I found out that you can. Fear, as it turns out, won't kill you. In fact, fear does not even interfere with your ability to pursue goals, learning goals. Wow, that was a revelation. That was one of the many lessons I learned that year. No matter if you're afraid, you can still learn. You can still focus. Well, almost all of us made it through the year. One of our group got kicked out. And some of you may know her story. Minnie Jean Brown got kicked out in February of 58. They call it, in some historical accounts, the chili incident happened in the cafeteria. Well, we were always being pushed and shoved, and one day in the cafeteria, Minnie was just fed up with all of it. Huh, it's interesting I use that metaphor for the cafeteria. Well, anyway, so she's standing there with her tray, walking, and this student pushes his chair back to impede her progress. So there he is, blocking the path. There she is, standing above him with this tray of food. And I could just see the little wheels clicking in her head. Should I or should I not share my lunch with this kid? She eventually decided in the affirmative. She upended that tray on his head. Now, the historians call it the chili incident, but Minnie Jean, if she were here today, she would tell you it wasn't just the chili. It was the chili, yes, but it was the milk, the Jell-O, the salad, the roll, the dessert, all of it. She freely shared it. Well, the next day, someone returned the favor and covered her with food. And after that, Minnie Jean swore off nonviolence and began to fight. And at that point, the school stepped in and they said, Minnie Jean, for your own safety and well-being, we're expelling you from school. In the wake of her expulsion, little cards were circulated all over that campus. One down, eight to go. So they cranked the pressure up on the rest of us. We, the remaining eight, simply rededicated ourselves to nonviolence and hung in there for the rest of the year, although it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy at all. And for me, though, I was okay with not fighting because I have never believed in fighting. And I know I live in a nation of violence. You know, we the people are a violent we the people. Arkansas, as an example, Arkansas was admitted to the Union in the year 1836. Check this out on the internet. The next year, 1837, the Speaker of the House killed a fellow legislator on the House floor, with a bowie knife, just knifed him to death, right there. Why? Because he'd said something the guy didn't like. Colleagues were saying if he kept his mouth shut, he'd be alive today. Well, a jury was convened, a trial ensued. The verdict? Justifiable homicide. He was right in killing him. Violence underscored, violence perpetuated. So, more recent example of violence, my wife and I were at a house party recently, and we noted at some point we were alone in one part of the house. All the other partygoers were stuffed into one room, and there were these noises emanating as if a television were on, and we went and looked over the shoulders and found that they were watching something called UFC. You ever hear of that? Called the Ultimate Fighting Championship. Well, it's two people who are trying to kill each other on TV for our entertainment. Violence to the extreme. We left the party simply because when people get caught up in that stuff, it has a tendency to spill over. Who knew what might happen? I don't. Well, in any case, we, the remaining eight, once Minnie was gone, got through that year somehow. At the end, one of our group graduated. Ernie Green was the only senior. The seven of us who were there were not allowed to attend the ceremony. That was considered too dangerous. So the Army went on our behalf, Ernie and the Army at the graduation. Afterwards, we met with Ernie and talked about what had happened. And he said things went okay. One kid spit on him, but other than that, it was all right. And he got his diploma, which he was there to get. So I'm going to now open up our dialogue because that's the most important part. But I have a couple of caveats, because I know I've been in schools around the country, and a lot of your counterparts are addicted to using certain kinds of language. Overuse of the word like is endemic. I hope it's not true here. So we will rule that out. So when you frame your question, put that aside. Now, after this assembly, you can go back to auditioning to be a valley girl if you want to. That's your choice. But here, we're going to leave that crowd behind, and we're going to have an intelligent conversation. Also, I want you to refrain from the use of guttural utterances before you begin your statement, as in, I don't understand the meaning of those sounds. So if you will just speak your truth, we will go from there. So who is person number one? And person number one, you are on the spot. You are a guinea pigish to the extreme because you're going to have to fight off your own tendency to give in to that peer pressure to speak that foreign language. Yes, stand right up and speak from the diaphragm. Good question. Have I been to Central since Ernie graduated? Yes, in fact, I was there last week. I go often. The school is now a national park. Little Rock Central High School is the only operational high school in the country which is also a national park. By the way, because it's a national park, feel free to visit at any time. You'll get a tour even while school is going on. I go often because programs are there. We went, I say we because Ernie Green and I were there together this past week, celebrating the 100th anniversary of the birth of Daisy Bates. Daisy Bates was a woman who was socially active, politically active when we were teenagers on our behalf. She paved the way in many ways for us to go to Central High School. And I was also there as part of a kickoff tour for a book fair that will go around the country encouraging young people to read more books. And I will do that to you today too. In fact, I'm going to assign you right now the task of reading one book a week from now on in addition to everything else you're reading. Just add that in. And then after a year or two, I want you to increase it to 2 books a week. Just get that notion, right? So you're reading, reading, reading. Why? Because you don't know much. And I know this is true because I don't know much. But I have a great deal of respect for my own storehouse of ignorance, and I know that that need not be a permanent condition, so one way to remedy that is to read voraciously so that you can file away stuff in your brain. And by the way, you don't have enough room in your brain for some of that stuff that you're watching on television, so you may want to give up some of that. Especially anything with reality in the title, just cross that off automatically. You don't need it. Okay, number two. Yes, stand right up. This is cool. Your peers love you.
Thank you. Do you wish that you could have graduated from high school?
No, actually I don't. Although, I was prepared to. And I say no because I am never wedded to institutions. I pledge no allegiance to geography, i.e., if I were born in Boston, I would never say I'm glad to be a Bostonian. I consider myself a citizen of the universe, and wherever I am, if there happens to be a school, I will graduate from it. So I don't have those ambitions or needs, for that matter. But that's a great question. And by the way, that's a question I've never had, which is very rare. I love that. Yes. Stand, and before you go further, you inadvertently let out a guttural utterance. You may not even realize it, but don't do it. Have I ever written a book? Oh, yes, yes, I'm glad you asked a question. I'll do this commercial. I want each of you, in that one book a week you're reading, to make it Lessons from Little Rock by Terry Roberts, okay? Yeah, now, how did I forget that? Right, yes. Lessons from Little Rock. And in fact, in there you'll get more details about my year at Central, but you'll also get a lot of other things. At the end of the book, I do a personal profile on all the other 8 members of the group, the Little Rock Nine. And most of them say that I captured them, that I got the essence of them, except for Gloria. Gloria claims I didn't get her just right, but she's wrong. But read for yourself. By the way, available at Amazon, Kindle versions are available, yes. Or other e-readers, stand right up, speak loudly. Star power, you know. How do I feel about white people? I love that. I need to offer a preamble before I answer this question, because there is no such thing as white people, except as part of a social construct. There is no biological definition for such a person. I feel fortunate to have grown up in a household with a mom who taught me that very early on. She said, Terry Roberts, this whole thing about race is so mythological, I can't begin to tell you how crazy it is. Then she explained the circumstances. In the universe, there is a single pool of genes. It's finite gene pool. Every human being who has ever lived, every human being now alive, human beings yet to be born, will pull out of that finite gene pool a unique combination of genetic components. That adds up to you. Ergo, every single human being in the universe is different from every other human being. Now, what makes the difference among us is ancestry, not race. Ancestry, that's quite different. The order of people in your past who have resulted in this young lady showing up in Brookline, that's ancestry. It has nothing to do with this crazy thing called race. So, the bigger answer is, how do I feel about people? And I love people. All people are my friends. Some of them don't know it. Some of them think they're my enemies. But it has nothing to do with whiteness or blackness. Now, I know that's a big concept to wrap your mind around, because it may be, for some of you, the first time you've heard anybody say that race is mythological. But the truth is there, and all you have to do is follow up and read about it for yourself. But the idea that we would divide people up into little groups is insane. And yet, we have done it, which is one of the reasons why I despaired in 1941 when I first came into the universe, because all this stuff was still there. It was there in 1941, it's there in 2014. Incredible that it could continue, and yet it does. We, as a collective, have not yet learned how to cope with the difference that defines us. We're all different from each other. Each time you talk to another human being, that is an exercise in coping with difference, always. Now, you may have mentally trained yourself to think about it otherwise, i.e., members of racial groups. In fact, if you talk to Joe Boston on the corner and ask him or her, which racial group are you a member of, they might say, I am proud to be a member of fill-in-the-blank race, right? All nonsense. But it's a true fact that we have been so miseducated that we believe. The mythological constructs that we believe in are legion. Race is not the only one. There are many, many. Some of you might believe in the myth of peer pressure, for instance. You ever hear that, peer pressure? You believe in it? Yes, he's undecided. The truth is, there is no such thing. There's only ignorance and stupidity, okay? It's not peer pressure. If you do what other people do, you're stupid. I mean, come on. Why would you all try to be valley girls by saying like incessantly and call it peer pressure? It's not peer pressure, according to Terry Roberts. It's just stupid behavior. Now, you can do better. You can use your brain and think about the decisions you're going to make. And it's essential that you do that if you're going to be truly able to contribute to this society what you have the potential to contribute. But if you only manifest that which you think others want you to do, I was proud to meet a young man this morning at another school who was not at all impressed with peer pressure, because he'd shown up clad in a way that defined him as truly an individual. And I applauded him for that, because I saw myself in him. I would never give in to convention, ever. Why? Because I thought it was dangerous. I didn't even want to be remotely identified with the crowd. I wanted to stand out. So some may call it arrogance. Maybe. People sometimes do consider me to be an arrogant person. I don't necessarily buy that. I just am so truly in love with Terry Roberts that I want to present myself as a unique being that I know I am. And you can do the same. You don't have to be just like him or her, right? Okay, so what else? Yes, right here, stand up. Speak loudly, no likes. Good question. Were all of the soldiers at the high school white or some of them black? They were all white. Now, there were black soldiers in the entire troop, but the commanding officer made a decision not to have black soldiers on the scene for fear that their presence alone would incite the crowd to further violence. So strategically, he left them back at their command post, and the soldiers on the scene were all white. I've talked to some of them, white and black, from that particular unit, and they all agree that that was a sound decision. They think the commander made the right decision, because violence may have ensued. In fact, I thought it might, because my default position that entire year was this: if anything goes wrong and I'm in danger, I'll just jump behind these soldiers and they will mow people down on my behalf. Well, I talked about that once to a group, and the student raised his hand. He said, I thought you were nonviolent. I had to admit. I said, I am nonviolent. Unless somebody's after me, then I'm violent. I think he understood it. I'm not quite sure I understand it, but I do know this. I am capable of violence, as you are, but I choose not to use violence. How about that as a true statement? I choose to live in peace. That's a good example of non-conformity to peer pressure. See, if we were to look at ourselves as a nation, we are basically violent. We want to bomb people and shoot people because we think that's the right thing to do. I'm an outlier. I don't want to bomb or kill anybody. I want everybody to live in peace. Yeah, I can see the debates now, but what about if they won't let you live in peace? Then you have to kill them, right? I don't know. We even have the death penalty in this country. We kill people because we don't like them. Or we say it's because they do wrong. Wow, that's pretty heavy stuff. Because from my knowledge of that sort of thing is, I'm a member of that group who says, he who is without sin, let him cast the first stone. That'd be my point of view. Okay, yes sir, stand right up. Yes sir.
As much as I appreciate everybody's desire to acknowledge their peers, if we could hold off on the clapping every time.
Okay, let me say at the end, we're going to applaud all the questioners. How about that? Group applause, but not right now. You're not being slighted, sir. Ah, good question. He says, and I quote, what was the thing you remembered most? That is such a big question. I don't know the full answer, but I'll choose something. I'll close my eyes and go, whoop, okay. There it is. What is it? Lord only knows. Well, I don't know. I don't know the answer. That's a stumping question. You know why? There's so many competing things. A lot of crazy stuff happened, although there were some things that might be considered good stuff that happened. I'll tell you one. One of my classmates actually shared her book with me in algebra, which was a really remarkable experience because one of the real taboos that year was anything that had to do with a white female and a black male being too close to each other. And she was a white female pulling her desk over so that I could share her algebra book. And one of the reasons for that, the situation that necessitated her doing that, I could never keep any supplies or books. Kids would knock those out of my arms and destroy them on the spot. Pencils, books, notebooks, whatever. Didn't matter, they just tear it up. So I'm often without anything. Robin Woods was a young woman who shared her book. That stands out. Now I know the answer. Thank you. Very cool. Yes, way in the back.
What was your opinion of General Faubus?
Governor Faubus?
Yeah, sorry.
My opinion of Governor Faubus. I actually gave Faubus some credit for trying. He was a man devoted to segregation, but he hadn't been always. Faubus actually grew up in a household that would be considered by standards of the times a liberal household. But as a politician, he saw the handwriting on the wall. He knew he could not attain the governorship without giving voice to segregationist principles. But then he decided to go full bore into that. So I fault him for that. I also know that the man was not that bright. I'll tell you why. After that 1 year of desegregated school at Central High, the governor was upset because he didn't want this to continue. He wanted to have that school return to its status as all white. So he closed down all high schools in Little Rock to keep black students out. And why I say he wasn't too bright was that when he closed the school to keep out all the black students, he automatically barred all the white students too. Why he didn't know that, I just have to conclude he wasn't that bright. But then, as I look at it carefully, I note that he's not alone. There is no requirement in this country that politicians have a measurable IQ. You don't have to be bright. You have to be chronologically eligible. You have to have enough money to pay the filing fee. But then, if you can convince enough like-minded idiots to vote for you, you can hold office. That's incredible. But that's our reality. I'm stuck with it. You're stuck with it. By the way, some of you are going to be voters very soon, a few short years. I say some of you because I know all of you are not interested in that. I don't know why, by the way. And I'd like to urge you to rethink it. But becoming active voters in the system means that you can change some of this. You might even wind up running for office yourself. What's your name? Last name? President Zelikson. See, doesn't that sound? Doesn't that have a ring? All righty. All right. So I would vote for him. Yes. First and then second. Try it again. Oh, did we think it was going to be so uproariously crazy? Her question, did I think things would be so bad on day one at school? Yes and no. We thought there would be opposition. We thought the opposition would be vocal and loud and boisterous, but then dissipate and the folk would go home. We miscalculated. They were there forever. So we missed that one. Yes. Whoa, you guys are infecting each other. Guttural utterance. That's all right. Don't be sorry. Just don't do it. I can't get through. I can't get through. I'm having a tough time. Help me, help me, help me get through. Okay. Wow, that's a good question. She's talking about Alex Wilson, reporter for the, I think it was a defender he was working for, Memphis State Defender. Alex, and what makes the story so poignant? He was a veteran. I say was because he died, I think in part due to those injuries he suffered. But he was a veteran of the wars protecting this country, and now he has to suffer this ignominious kind of treatment on the streets of Little Rock, kicking and pushing, and then finally this guy crack him in the head with that brick. I still think about that. I mean, I have that image in my mind along with some others that hold prominence, because I think it was so dastardly a thing to have happen to any human being, especially to Alex, because he was a man who simply wanted to report the truth, and here he is being assaulted in that very vicious way. Thank you. Great question. Absolutely. Yes, sir. Did you say you know what I'm going to do now? We got a new thing going. If you say you're disqualified, and we're going to move on to this guy, and then we'll come back to you. Stand up.
Wait, so it's saying that the guy got away with the red dot?
I did say that. He's being very safe. Did you see that? Yes. Okay, nope. Disqualified. Her question, what was my goal attending the school and was I successful? My goal was to finish my junior year. I was indeed successful. I had no other goal. I chose to go because the law was on my side. Central High was my neighborhood school. I lived exactly 6 blocks away. I could walk to school. To get to the all-black school, the school that the school board had designated for all-black students, was on the other side of town from where I lived, on the east side near the airport. I used to wonder why they put that school near the airport. I had those visions of big transport planes taking us all out some crazy place. Just fantasy. But I also went because I wanted to demonstrate to all the people in Little Rock and perhaps others who were watching from around the world that it was possible for us to live up to what we said we were about, and that is we are a law-abiding nation. Even though that's only lip service in many ways, but I wanted to prove that there was substance to that. Okay, remember, a guttural utterance will get you disqualified. Did he say,
Yes, he did.
Stand right up. Did anyone harass me at home? Yes. In fact, we had drive-bys, although we didn't have that terminology. But we did have. In fact, the neighbor's car was trashed 4 separate times. They parked it too close to our home. Weapons of choice that year were shotguns and dynamite. Vicious stuff. Also, they employed the telephone. We received hate messages by phone continuously, 24/7. Hate mail by the bushel. I, in my focus as a student, began to correct the grammar on some of the hate mail. There are a lot of bigots out there who are simply unable to write a sentence using correct grammar. And I think if you're going to be a bigot, at least you ought to be smart about it. I mean, come on. Bigotry is bad enough to be a dumb bigot. Okay, yes. Ah, good question. Were the teachers and the soldiers nice to us? I'll start with the soldiers. The soldiers were very nice to us because they had been ordered to protect us. And what I found out about the military, military people follow orders. If they are ordered to be nice, they are nice. Otherwise, they face disciplinary action. Teachers, on the other hand, were under no such threat. They could be terrible to us, and some of them were. I arranged them along a continuum. Some at this end who supported our presence in the school, those at this other end who hated us with vile passion and everything you can imagine in between. Now, for survival's sake, I divided them up that year into two groups, a small group who supported us and the rest. Those were my two groups that year. And I had representatives from that entire continuum. My algebra teacher would stand over here as a supporter. My English teacher, on the other hand, was one of the vile haters. My English teacher communicated to me very clearly on day one that she hated me because she twisted her face into a mask of hate. I would replicate that face for you here today if I could, but I don't know how one human being can twist his or her face to that degree. This woman was expert. In fact, I concluded on day one that this would be the class in which I received an F for the first time in my life, because I knew this teacher had it in for me. Guess what happened, though, at the end of term? An A. Oh, I got an A grade in English. Well, I think this teacher gave me an F initially, let's say it was on a Monday, but then went home Monday night, had this agonizing night, night of anguish and despair, snuck in early Tuesday morning, and slashed down the right side of that F and transformed it into an A. That's theory number one. Theory number two, she could not deny genius in her presence. Just couldn't do it. Forced to write the A in spite of herself. Even bigots have to give in to the truth. Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, two-part question. Did we interact with the soldiers, and to what degree? And did we have classes together? Second part first. We, the nine, were assigned homerooms based on our class standing, i.e., 10th, 11th, or 12th grade, and then within those three categories, alphabetically by last name. Five of us were juniors, three were sophomores, and one was senior. Our names were so disparate that we did not have homerooms together. Our class schedules were based on our homeroom, so we never had class together. We might be considered that year the Little Rock 1 nine times as opposed to the Little Rock 9. Great question, although you said twice, and I'll remember that. Well, okay, that's it, kiddo. See, this stuff is very strict. It's strict, there's no second chance. Sound? Yes. Actually, that's a good question. Because I thought about it, and being in Little Rock was not good for me, because I thought it was that part of the world we call the South, and they're backwards and so forth. But I've since recalibrated my mental map. Now, in my map, anything south of Canada is the South, so it wouldn't have mattered where I was born. I would still be in the same trouble. So no, I have no illusions about that. By the way, I urge you to recalibrate your maps too, so that anything south of Canada now becomes the South, and you're not just relegating the South to that little southeastern portion of these United States. So right here in Boston, we are in the South. Yeah. Well, your history is just kind of nutty anyway. You know, it was right here in Massachusetts, in Boston. Supreme Court case, I think it was 1852, if I'm correct, Roberts versus City of Boston. I love that case, primarily for the surname of the plaintiff, my ancestor, no doubt. Roberts wanted to send his kids to Boston School. Boston School District said, no way. He says, why? Your kids are black. He said, well, I know they're black. They're my kids. What are you talking about? Yeah, but black kids can't go to school. So Roberts took his case to the Massachusetts State Supreme Court. Guess what happened? The Supreme Court upheld the verdict of the school district. Roberts could not send his kids to the Boston Public Schools in 1852. Now, fortunately, the state legislature overruled that later. They changed the law. But that was in place. So you here in Boston have this kind of nutty history, yes. Remember the rule. No, we'll give you a pass on that, okay? Because you're trying. Go for it. But be diligent. Be diligent. Great question. See, and I applaud you for not giving in to that urge to go guttural on me. I moved from Little Rock to Los Angeles, moved in with relatives, finished at LA High, which was good, and I, in retrospect, see it as a blessing because a number of my age group contemporaries had no such opportunity. Many kids, black and white, that year of the closed schools, had no school to attend. In Prince Edward County, Virginia, the governor closed all schools, not just high schools, elementary, middle schools, and high schools for 4 years consecutively. Imagine what would happen in the city of Bedford if there were no schools at all for 4 years. Can you imagine what would happen to the populace? Already in trouble, but now further in danger because they know very little. Way in the back. Did I ever consider dropping out? You better believe it. Every second of every day, I wanted to run out of that place. It was so hard to be there, so hurtful, so painful, so utterly discouraging. I was in a state of despair most of the time. I just wanted to quit. But I kept going back, mainly because one side of my brain would win the argument. One side of the brain would say, "You've done your bit, Terry Roberts. You can go now, leave." The other side would say, "Nope, job's not over yet." And that side would win. And then I would go to school frightened and angry, angry with that side of the brain. Yes. Did you ever? I'm just kidding. Go ahead. At Central?
Yeah.
She's asking if I ever had a high school reunion at Central. No, because I didn't graduate from Central. I graduated from Los Angeles High School. Did I like meet anybody? How's that work? Is that different from actually meeting people? No, I'm just trying to figure it out. I'm just confused. I'm just trying to figure it out. Yes. Ah, good question. Was there anything I enjoyed about going to Central? Yes. You know what I enjoyed most? The library. The library. Not only because they had such wonderful books in there, but the librarian would not allow people to beat me up in the library. Oh, such a sanctuary. When I could go in there, but she was a stickler. You could not go into the library unless you had a valid reason. It was a small library. You had to write out a permission slip for yourself, but in doing so, you had to write the reason for being in the library. I ran out of reasons that she would accept. One day, she turned me down because I had wrote, "I need to be in the library to bask in the ambiance of a safe environment." She said, "No way," which I thought was legitimate. Yes. I can tell by your attitude that you're ready.
Okay.
All right.
During your time at Little Rock, what did you want to be when you grew up?
His question, what did I want to be when I grew up? The honest truth, I'm still working on it. I'm still trying to figure out what I'm going to be when I grow up. You know, they tell you when you're young that at some point you're going to grow up and you become an adult. Don't believe them. Who you are now is who you will be then. In some cases, whoa, that's a big problem, unless you get your act together right away. But I've been aware of that. I have been open to going with the flow, and I have found it to be effective for me. I found my way into psychology, going with the flow, and it turned out to be exactly the niche I was born for. I am a natural-born psychologist. It never felt like work. Yes, sir. All right, I love that. He's anticipating the like and the and he moves in with, all right. Go for it. No, no, go ahead. Go ahead, because I sense that you are going to overcome. Okay, I'm going to try and piece together what you're saying. Had there been other people besides black people and white people, what would have gone down? Oh, okay. I sort of get it. Sort of like. I am really confused by that language, folks. But what he's saying, in essence, is what would have happened had I been Hispanic or Asian rather than black in that environment? I have absolutely no clue. Part of the reason why is there were very few people other than black people or white people in Little Rock at that time. Now, I do remember there was one Asian family, and I don't remember where they may have been from ancestrally, but they ran a grocery store at the corner, and black people and white people shopped there, but they didn't have kids. At least I didn't have kids in school where I was. It's hard to know. I have seen interviews with some of the students from Central who said, and they gave voice to these sentiments, that had we been Hispanic, perhaps they would have been more accepting. And the answer given was because, well, they're more like us. Sort of inane, but there it was. Who can support that kind of craziness? Yes. This young lady. Stand right up and... Pardon? You didn't have a question? But you had your hand up. You just practicing? Okay. Yes. Yeah, gotta stand up and speak loudly from the diaphragm. Her question is, do I know any of the people who attacked me at school? Do I know them personally today? Yes. The one who stands out is a woman named Hazel Bryant. All of you have actually seen Hazel, because she is part of a very iconic photo taken by photographer Will Counts on day one at Central. Elizabeth is walking along with her dark glasses, clutching her books. Behind her, with her mouth wide open, is Hazel, yelling out this racist invective. She and I have had a meeting. She apologized, said she was sorry. She self-identifies as having been the poster child for American racism in 1957. But she's given it up as an adult. She has kids of her own. One day, she said, it came to her in a flash. I don't want my kids to have the same life that I had. So she began to extricate herself from her family of origin. She is currently persona non grata at home. But she's okay with that. Often that is the case. If you give up on the family tradition, you might find yourself an outsider. Yes, on the end. Stand right up. See, she gives me an and a like in succession. What is going on? Yes. What is my fondest memory from junior year? Thanksgiving. I had 4 days off. Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. That stands out as a relief period. Yes. Good question. I love this question because I am working on some new projects. Her question is, what are you working on right now and why? I do a lot of writing. I was most recently at a conference where authors and illustrators and publishers of children's books were present. I am now imbued with this notion that I need to write children's books. So I immediately went and began to write ideas, and I have a legal pad full of notions about what that's going to do. In the near future, look for books written by Terry Roberts, designed for young readers. That's my current mission. That's not my only mission, but it will accompany some of the other stuff that I'm doing, yes. Her question, am I still friends with some of the other members of the Little Rock Nine? Yes. In fact, eight of us remain alive. Jeff Thomas died about 4 years ago. We still hang on to that notion of the Little Rock Nine. We are members of the board of the Little Rock Nine Foundation. You can find information about us on the web at www.littlerock9.com. In the near past, we actually gave scholarships to students. We don't anymore, as we realized, as board members, we're beginning to age out, don't have as much stamina. Some of our group are physically incapacitated even as we speak. it would be difficult for us to maintain that pace of reading the applications and awarding scholarships. So we turned over our operation to the Clinton Foundation. So the Clinton Foundation now houses the Little Rock Nine Foundation. We still want donations, but those monies will now go as scholarships to students at the Clinton School of Public Policy in Little Rock. Yes. His question, do I know why people would be prejudiced against others based on skin tone? I don't know the answer. But I have some suspicion that those skin colors are seen as markers that trigger things in brains that are not healthy. A whole range of stereotypical thought probably exists there, triggered by a black or brown face. I don't know. Interestingly, though, I mean, psychologists, some of my colleagues have probed this over time trying to figure it out. They've come up with some notions, none of which are adequate to explain the intensity of opposition. My hunch is that it's probably something that we will never know fully. Yes, sir. Did you say I love that. Disqualified halfway up. Yes. I am sorely tempted to break into song at this point. But how did I feel after the first year? Remember James Brown? I feel good. I still feel good. Yes. The kid that was... Oh, okay. His question, how did my parents feel about the kid that was bullying me? You know, they actually had a description of him. They called him the kid with the foul mouth. That tells you a little bit about how they felt. And particularly because I was their son and he was giving me all of that trouble, they didn't like him very much. They probably had very negative thoughts about him, which they did not share fully with me, which was probably very politic because it may have influenced my attitude toward him. I already had a lot of negative feelings I had to deal with about him. Yes. Yes, he did. I heard him. I heard him. You can't give him a pass if he says, yes, right.
But what was going through your head when you first arrived at Little Rock High?
Good question. What was going through my head was, am I going to make it out of here alive? Is this the day my name winds up on the coroner's report, or do I get to live another day? That was the thought. Not a very refreshing thought when you think about it. Did they have any Okay, I don't think I'm right. His question was, with a very liberal acceptance of his guttural use through the sentence, did my parents have any reservations about me or concerns going to Central? You know, when I came home and told them that I had volunteered, they offered this. We will support your decision 100%. And here's what else they said. If things get too hot and you want to quit, we will support your decision to quit 100%. I had the best of all worlds. Now, I didn't realize it at the time, but that's one of the things that helped sustain me through the year, because I knew I could stay or leave without fear of losing their esteem. That was very important. Yes, sir. Oh, now that's a very good question. One that bears some looking at. Is it true that some kids were racist because of their parents? Here's my take on that. As kids, we are vulnerable to parents. When you're quite young, you're like sponges. You soak up everything that parents tell you. However, at some point, you individually have to take responsibility for what you think and what you do. So I can never agree that it was because of the parents. I admit that that does have an influence on you, but at some point, as part of the growth and maturation, regardless of where it comes from, parents or other people, we are charged with the responsibility of sifting through all the craziness and throwing away the stuff that doesn't work, but taking that which is true and making decisions on that basis. And I say that strongly as I do, because often people will hide behind that concept, oh, my parents made me do it. No. No. Your parents are who they are. And they will be that way until they change, or if they change. But your task is to be you, and you make your own decisions. Yes. Her question, did I think the Little Rock Nine originally would have such an impact on school desegregation? No. My thought was that we would take our place in the long line of people who had been fighting against this unfair system for years, for decades, had no idea things would blow up the way they have to such an extent. What happened in Little Rock is now memorialized in many ways. There are 9 life-size statues on the Capitol grounds in Little Rock of us, the 9. There's a postage stamp with a likeness of our group. There's a Cohen, I think it's a dollar Cohen. I think it costs $45 to buy it, but it's all a worthy cause. But all of this stuff, focused on Little Rock 9, seems to give it more credence than some of the other things that have happened. And in fact, that has created a bit of controversy with some who say, in terms of equality, you guys are getting more than your share of publicity, etc., which in the way we run things is probably an accurate description, unfairly so, because we have used as a measure too often publicity. It's like we do with people like Kim Kardashian, for instance. What gives her the right to be a public figure? On the surface, she doesn't have that much to offer, but yet there are a lot of folk who feel that she is the it girl. You ready? Okay. Give him a shot here. He's struggling.
Do you think that because of this whole Little Rock experience, that you're discriminated against more than you would have
otherwise? Ah, great question. Great question. I don't know the answer. I do know that prior to my going to Little Rock Central High School, I had a lot of customers who happened to be white people in Little Rock. I did a leaf raking in the fall and lawn mowing business in the summer. I had a lot of customers, but once it was found out that I was now going to Central, all my customers dropped me. I had no business. And that was devastating, especially because one woman had this 1939 Packard automobile in her garage. Her husband had died years before. She did not drive. So this car sat there on blocks. And I had bargained with her. She was going to sell me that car for $100. I'm saving up my money, but the transaction didn't happen because Central intervened. She fired me, and the car deal was off. I regret that to this day, because that old automobile would be worth a fortune today. And I could have had it for $100. Yes?
How did the discrimination affect your learning?
How did the discrimination affect my learning? I don't think it did, actually. And I'd say on behalf of all 9 of us, we went to Central as very good students. We really took education seriously. We studied hard. We wanted to learn. We would not allow the crazy noise in the system to interfere with that, even at Central. It was difficult, certainly. But the point is that if your goals are insight, if you can see them clearly, nothing will stand in your way. By the way, I have something to share with you. I've been walking around looking at your faces. As a trained psychologist, I can see signs of brain damage on your face. And I am happy to report, so far, I've not seen any sign of brain damage, which tells me that all of you are in possession of healthy, intact brains. By definition, those are A brains. Your brain is capable of earning A's. Now, some of you, for whatever reason you want to give, have used your perfectly good A brain in the service of earning grades other than A. Now, my question to you is, why? It's rhetorical. You don't have to answer, especially in public. But it's imperative that you take time to ask yourself that question in the privacy of your own home. Why am I not using my brain in the way it was designed to be used? Yes, sir. I'm going to wake you up. I love that yawn, though. So relaxed. Say that again without all those ums.
And the difference from your school, from now, what are the people that you school?
Okay, he almost did it, free. He's working hard. Question, and I actually don't know the answer, but I'm going to say the question. What do some of the folk who were giving me so much trouble then think about me now? I don't know. And you know why? I don't know. Because what other people think about me is none of my business. What other people think about you is none of your business. Think about that. How much energy you would save if you put aside that belief that what other people think about you is your business. Let's say you're walking across the school here at Bedford, school grounds. Somebody yells out, "Hey, stupid!" What have I done? I have just signed a social contract that stupid applies to me. Question, why am I turning around? Why am I turning around if somebody yells out stupid? Answer, if you know your name, you are never distracted by stuff that has no relation to you. So whatever is called out, you know in advance it's not you because you know your name. So at Central, I knew my name. So when people called out stuff, it had nothing to do with me. Didn't matter what it was, I knew that that was not my name. You understand that? Okay, so if somebody calls you stupid, you know in advance, that's not you. Right? You got a detractor back there. Okay, this guy right here. Okay, those were two options. Any more? Okay. He's giving me a forced choice question. Did we think of ourselves as a movement or just as nine individuals? Could be more options, but I don't know what they are. I'll have to give that some thought. I hadn't thought about that. I usually am so focused on me, everything else sort of fades into, you know how they do sometimes on the movies, a fade out? That's how life is. When I show up, there's a great spotlight on Terry Roberts. And everything else fades into the background. I guess that may be the second part. Just nine, just an individual. Right, okay, you're gonna try it again. No arms, right? No arms, no likes, yes. Oh, what did you say? Jordan 23. You gotta do better, okay. Yes, now remember last time, you gave me a bunch of arms and likes. Okay. That's all right. She can't help herself, I guess. Good. Her question is, and I have to go because the people are standing up. Okay, so that was the last question. But see, I'm going to give the answer to that one, and then I'm going to have some words of conclusion. I have seen the movie. In fact, I was a consultant on the Ernie Green story by Disney. By the way, Disney is very cheap. They don't pay much. In case you have career aspirations. I like the movie. It's one of those movies that, but for a couple of scenes that are pure fantasy, the rest is accurate. And by the way, when you read stuff or see stuff on the screen, know in advance that not all of it is true. Your task is to figure out what part of it is true and what is not. In conclusion, if you take the advice I was given as a first grader, you will already have become executive in charge of your own learning. You will not rely upon other people to tell you what you need to know or how to learn it. You will notice in some schools that there are two tracks, whatever class you're in. One track is for you to do what's required, and the other is to learn. Your task is to do both. Do what's required so you can advance through this system, but also don't forget to learn while you're doing it. And also, last thing, keep in mind that you have to challenge yourself a lot. So here's the question. When was the last time you did something for the first time? Okay, gang, take it and go.